I am Aris Winger, and I am an assistant professor of mathematics at Georgia Gwinnett College. That's a great question, and I get that question a lot, right? So a lot of work that I'm doing is actually calling that into question about the fact that it's natural at all, right? So I guess my start in mathematics came from one of my earliest mathematical memories is, you know, doing two-digit battles at the board in fourth or fifth grade, right? Where, you know, I was pitted against other people and winning those battles. And so, you know, from that, I had been given this identity now that like, oh, Aris is the fast math guy, right? And then that, like, that felt great, right? Because people were thinking of me in a higher sense. It was like I had a special power in some sense, and there was something unique and special about me. And so then that just carried on, you know, from semester to semester throughout, in a lot of ways, my whole life. I probably knew my first year at Howard University, right? When I went there and I was taking math classes, and it was still comfortable. And really, I guess it was sophomore year where I had to pick a major. And there was just nothing I was going to pick other than the most comfortable space that I had been in, right? So I knew I had to pick a major. So for me, and then after, I mean, even during my sophomore year, I was still going to be an actuary, right? And so, and then, you know, Cora Sadowski, you know, who I was having linear algebra from, she was like, you know what, you can get a PhD in math, actually. And I was just like, oh, that face you made, I made the same face, like, oh, I guess I can. And so that just changed everything for me. And so I just started really looking into, you know, math as a hardcore subject. I went to the joint meetings, and it was like, oh, I found my people in a lot of ways, right? And so it was just all downhill from there. I mean, my PhD's in partial differential equations, you know, that's the area. But right now I'm doing a lot of social justice mathematics, where I'm just really looking at the world and really trying to figure out how, you know, injustices show up mathematically, right? And so I've been doing a lot of stuff on racial profiling, and I've been doing stuff on just disparities across the board in lots of different areas. And so it's an area that doesn't get enough focus in the mathematics discipline. So my big critique of mathematics right now is that there are too many problems that I think a lot of us could look at and be like, oh, that's just page 37 of this book, right? That's just a specific thing. And yet, either we're not looking, or we don't care enough to say, wait, we've solved this problem, actually. Like the route that one would take, that a food truck would take so that everybody gets fed in a neighborhood, right? That's a graph theory problem for days, right? And so it's like, it's that type of stuff that interests me more now than ever. Yeah, and thank you for asking that question about the struggles that I may have had, because, you know, one of the things I've learned as I get older is my ability to go back and reexamine those moments, right? And so thankfully for me, things that used to be really bad have turned, I've been able to find lessons from them, right? And so, you know, we just got out of the month of May. We're about to get out of the month of May. And so like May 9th was when my father died, when I was in 1989. So that was really big for me. It was 2 years after my mother had died of cancer. He died in a car accident, or for complications of the car accident. And so that was a space in which I felt very much alone in the world, right? And so specifically about May 9th now was Mother's Day, right? And so that has always been a day where I would think of my father passing away. I would think about not having a mother. And now these days, I think about my wife as a mother to my daughter, right? And so just reminding myself that, you know, when something happens, that the race is not over, right? That, you know, I just keep reminding myself of that, because for, you know, 15 years, that time in the calendar would always come around, and it would be like, right? And then, you know, what my wife will never fully understand, and my daughter will not understand, is that their existence and their being has created a light for me out of that real darkness that I can never repay them for, right? Now, at the time, this is why mathematics was so important to me in 89, that summer of 89. Like, I didn't know what to do, right? And so my grandmother took me in. And for the next, 5 to 7 years, I was numb as a person. Like, if you, that's now going into junior high school and to high school. If you speak to anybody who went to high school with me, they would say that I was super quiet, and they would be shocked that like I would be on a podcast or like talking with you like this, right? Because I was just completely shut off. And that's where mathematics shows up for me, right? Because that's where I ran. I mean, if you look at my report cards in 7th, 8th grade, it's like C, B, C, C, and A in math, A in math, A in math, A in math, right? It's just so telling about where I was trying to be and be valued and be uplifted. And so, to get through that, it was literally day by day. And my grandmother and aunt who raised me with my uncle as well, I mean, they just had this work ethic of just, let's just go to work every day. And like, there was not one day, my grandmother and my aunt lost a mother and a sister and a son-in-law, just like I lost a father and a mother. And, I looked at them as pillars of strength that they just kept moving along. And I was like, oh, I guess I just need to do the same thing, right? And it is true that, I should have seen somebody and gotten counseling and all of that stuff. But watching them somehow just continue to take the steps forward allowed me to do the same, to a point where finally, when I got older, I was able to really grapple with some of those issues. Yeah, so there's one professionally and then there's one personally. I mean, the personal one obviously is being the father of my daughter. It is the most incredible thing I could have ever imagined, right? So, I mean, that's, for me, it's obvious. And terrifying at the same time, right? To be a role model for her in some ways, and to know that I won't be perfect and those things will impact her, while at the same time trying to uplift her in this world as a future Black woman, is just like, yeah, an honor all of itself. And then like professionally, my greatest honor is always to just be a teacher. I mean, it's just being a teacher and to impact young people every day, right? So when young people or students in general just say thank you, that's always just a reoccurring honor. So I've just decided to like really just appreciate, the quote small things, right? That when people say that they appreciate or that I had any impact on, their lives in a positive way, that's all that I need to just keep going. So I'm sure there are other honors and stuff, but I just become so, particularly in these times, like I've just learned to just appreciate the quote small things. So I've been honored to have had a number of different role models. I mean, going to Dunbar Senior High School, which was an all Black high school, Howard was, an HBCU, which is a historically Black college and university. I mean, I got representation almost immediately. Like I didn't know, growing up in DC, which is majority Black as well, like I just never had the issue of not looking mathematically at somebody and, or questioning whether I could do it because I didn't see anybody look like me. So definitely my high school teachers, Izigwe, Mr. Izigwe, Mr. Mbaye, these are African teachers. And then for me, the seminal moment was, analysis when James Donaldson came in, a Black man, came in with a suit on, he took off his jacket, and he said, "This is intro to analysis," and he just started writing. And at the time, I said, this is who I want to be, right? This is just, and so as I mentioned before, Cora Sadowski told me what was possible about me as an Argentinian woman, but I saw the personification of it in a Black man at the board when James Donaldson was up there. And so the combination of those two things, having someone who the world tells us that should have no connection to me, right, to step out and say, I believe in your potential. And then that combined with the very next semester, that combined with, a Black man saying, I am your future, right? You can be exactly what I am. It did everything for me. And I'm continuing to understand the importance of that years and years later, right? At the time, it was just like, but those were the two. I guess if I had words of wisdom, it would just say stick with the subject. I mean, even in the face when people tell you that you don't belong in it, right? That, I mean, I see a world that is written in the language of mathematics. We use mathematics in the society to uplift people. We use mathematics to trick and fool people. It is just, it's so vitally important to the human existence. And so I would say to anybody who, you know, is in the discipline to please connect and find your community, right? That community is out there, and find it, people to connect to. When I found, you know, for a long time, I was alone in the mathematical world because of stuff that was very traumatic for me. And then I found people who were also interested in it, and it just lit up the world for me, right? And so just keep plugging away. And thankfully now we are in a world where the internet has shrunk it, right? And so now with an email, with a post on somebody's Facebook page, with a Twitter message, we can connect to people who are like us and sharing our experience. Please take advantage of that, because I get to be old and say, I didn't used to have that, right? I get to be old and say, I'm at a space where I predated that. And so please reach out and connect and know that you are not alone in this voyage.